Hello, I'm David Haines from Beaumont Hospital in Royal Oak, Michigan, and I'm really thrilled to be part of CAST AF2. It's a great lineup today, and I'm proud to be part of the faculty. Today, I'm going to talk about the biophysics of pulsed field ablation. This is a really hot area, tremendous interest, and I do think it will be the future of our field in AFib ablation. So comparing RF ablation to pulsed field, the main thing about the two technologies is the therapeutic range. We can make effective lesions with radiofrequency ablation, but when there are collateral tissues that can be damaged, the range of energy delivery is narrow and you can end up with collateral damage while you're trying to achieve therapeutic effect. Whereas with pulsed field, we get effective myocardial ablation with relative sparing of the neighboring tissues. So this is really a favorable technology. Now the determinants of electroporation success have to do with dielectric breakdown of the membrane by a voltage field. And you can see this cartoon of a biphasic field and the electromotive force that it's exerting on the cell membrane. With high enough field strength, you start to get breakdown of that membrane until you actually have pore formation. And this simulation shows the effect of the lipid bilayer membrane with a large field applied to it, where the hydrophilic heads create a pore, and that pore can allow ions and macromolecules to flow freely from the outside to the inside of the cell. Now, we've known about shock-induced electroporation and injury for a long time. The experiment demonstrated here shows the effects of a 10 millisecond pulse, which is a relatively long pulse compared to what we're using in pulsed field ablation, on action potential amplitude, DVDT, diastolic depolarization, and conduction velocity. And it's by creation of these pores that causes depolarization of the cell and breakdown of the cell, and ultimately can proceed on to cell death. Now, pulsed field ablation, unlike RF, has many parameters to be considered. The parameters are listed on the side here, and I won't go into all of the details, but you can see that each particular pulse has a variety of things that can be modulated, and each pulse can be put together in a train, can be monophasic or biphasic, and the pulse width and amplitude and train number and inner pulse distance, all of these things can be adjusted. And the question is, what's important and what translates into safe and effective ablation? Here's an experiment looking at the effect of an electrical field on an individual cell. And you can see in the first graph, as the applied potential is increased at a certain inflection point, there is breakdown of the dielectric membrane and current flow begins. So there is this threshold effect that is dependent on amplitude of the field. And it's dependent, as you can see here, on distance from the source as well. So the field falls off with increasing distance. And it's this field over distance that is the parameter that you will see in experiments on pulsed field ablation. Now, how do you deliver the pulse? You can deliver it just as a single square wave pulse, or you can deliver it as a biphasic pulse, and you can bunch those biphasic pulse waves closely together, or you can spread them out, and you can give a series of pulses over time, or a series of pulse trains over time, or a continuous pulse train. Now, in these experiments, the total energy delivered was the same for each of these conditions, but you can see how you break the pulse up, how long the pulse duration is very important in terms of the effect that you get. So you can see with the longer pulse, the 100 microsecond pulse width, you get significant cell injury at a relatively lower field strength, whereas if you use trains of shorter pulses, you require higher voltages to achieve the same effect. This is another meta-analysis looking at a number of studies with different pulse durations being tested, and you can see that as you increase pulse duration, the membrane effect is increased. And so this is something that many studies have shown in many different tissues over time. And this is a familiar looking curve to anyone who's in the pacing field, a strength duration curve. So higher amplitude, shorter duration, or lower amplitude, long duration, can achieve the same threshold effect. But you do reach asymptotic values, Kronaxy values. And you can see in this depiction, there is a range where there is no effect, there's a range where there's a reversible effect, and then you get into an irreversible effect. What about tissue heating? We talk about this being a non-thermal approach, and I think that that is the observation in most settings, that if there is temperature rise, it's in very, very close proximity to the to the electrode, and it's in the range usually of just a few degrees. Now, what other parameters can you modulate? Well, here's an experiment in a cellular preparation looking at a variety of different parameters. And you can see 50 versus 500 volt field, the higher voltage had more effect, not surprising. 10 versus 20 pulses, more effect. Here's something that's a little counterintuitive. When they delivered the pulses at a 2 hertz frequency versus 1 hertz, or a 4 hertz frequency versus 2 hertz, spreading out the pulses over a longer duration had more effect, where if you squeeze them all in a shorter duration, it was less effective. Now, one of the interesting things about cardiac tissue is that cardiac cells are polarized. They are resting at a minus 90 millivolts due to the Nernst potential and the potassium equilibrium. And you can see that depending on the field orientation to the cell and depending upon the phase, you get a predominant effect on one side of the cell, or if it's biphasic, you get it on both sides of the cell. And in a cardiac tissue, one directionality of phase will have more electromotive effect on the sarcolemmal membrane because of the polarity of the membrane versus the other phase effect. So cardiac tissue is special and probably accounts for its increased sensitivity to this approach. Now, the other important factor are the field effects, just the distribution of electricity in the tissue. And there are a lot of factors that go into that, unipolar versus bipolar, the distance of the bipolar delivery, presence of scar, connected tissue, blood pool, and the actual poration of the cells alters the milieu through which the electricity is transited. So unipolar versus bipolar delivery with a multipolar array, you get more localized field with bipolar delivery. You also don't get as much nerve and muscle stimulation. It may be better tolerated. But the lesion margins are more predictable and follow the boundary of this field, whereas the tissue conductance effects are much more of a factor when you have unipolar delivery, and how much energy is dissipated by the dispersive electrode is important as well. The interelectrode distance, interestingly, as you increase the distance between electrodes, the lesion actually gets bigger, and that has to do, again, with field distribution, and so you may find, whereas RF, we deliver in closely spaced electrodes with pulse field, wider spacing of electrodes might be preferable. The tissue, very important. Scar tissue has high water content, lower impedance, and will allow the passage of current more readily, whereas myocardium has higher impedance and more resistance. So you'll have current shunting into scar. This may be a favorable or an unfavorable effect with ablation of VT in scarred hearts. And you can see the effect of scar on water content. In an infarct versus normal, the water content is higher and impedance is lower. When you deliver electricity to a cell solution, as you pass that current through the cells, the sarcolemmal membrane breaks down and the conductivity actually increases because the electricity blows right through the cells. And you can see in this cell solution, as opposed to a comparison acellular buffer solution, as you increase the field, the conductivity actually increases. And so that's why a second pulse and a third pulse may have more effect than the initial pulse. And you can see here this effect as the number increases, conductivity change increases, and as the field increases, you have increased permeabilization and decreased survival. So in the clinical setting with pulse field ablation, we can see the publication by Dr. Reddy that as they iterated through various waveforms in their pilot trial, and I don't think they did a lot of preclinical testing, but they tested this in humans. You can see as they learned and as they altered the waveform, their success rates went up as the study continued. So in conclusion, pulse field ablation, irreversible electroporation, is accomplished by a breakdown of the dielectric membranes by high voltage fields. Efficacy of PFA is predominantly determined by field strength and pulse duration. Multiple other waveform parameters also contribute to the PFA effects, and tissue factors directly impact field distribution and field strength. Thank you.